Have you ever wondered what Christmas is like for a drug addict, an alcoholic? Well, stay tuned because I'm about to share my story about what Christmas is like for a drug addict. What's up, everybody? This is Chris from The Rewired Soul, where we talk about the problem, but focus on the solution. And this is kind of a story time video sharing about my struggles with addiction during Christmas time. But I also want to share my story for any addicts or alcoholics out there who are still struggling in active addiction. I want to explain how much better it gets too. So make sure you stay tuned until the end of this video because this isn't just a bunch of, oh, poor me or horror stories. Things do get better. Christmas went from one of my least favorite holidays to one of my favorite, all right? So anyways, I was the child of an alcoholic mom. I grew up hating Christmases. I hated them. I hated all the holidays, to be honest. My parents got divorced when I was about 4 years old. I lived with my dad. He raised me. And I started visiting my mom on the holidays. So Thanksgiving, Christmas, Easter, summer vacations, all that. But, you know, while most kids had very normal Christmases, my Christmases were an absolute nightmare. It was always worrying about what my mom was going to do on Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. We're talking like when most families are having this nice Christmas Eve dinner, everybody comes into town and it's all fun and yay. My mom would have a couple drinks and she's trying to stab or kill one of her brothers or sisters and it would be a hot mess. You know, I remember my stepdad having to carry her to the car, passed out, you know, and me just sitting in the backseat on the drive home just like, is this what Christmas is? But also growing up too, I didn't like Christmas that much. I always felt like an outsider in my own family because my sister was raised in Fresno, California, where I'm from, but I was living in Southern California, or later I moved to Las Vegas, where I currently live. And whenever I visited for Christmas, and like, I know Sherry, like, when I go back and share about this, it seems like, oh, woe is me. But some of you can relate to this. And I do want to share about, you know, how my addiction kind of came to fruition because a lot of it was based on my childhood. But anyways, whenever I would come and visit, like, my aunts, my uncles, my grandparents, and things like that, they would get my sister these very thoughtful gifts. And for any of you parents out there or uncles or aunts or grandparents, like, kids notice stuff. Like, I'm living proof of that. My sister was getting very thoughtful gifts. Like, they knew my sister. They knew what her likes were, her dislikes, and she'd open presents and they were catered to her. And me, it was almost like my presents were like this second afterthought, you know, like, oh wait, that kid Chris is coming, you know, like throw a gift card at him or just some random toy. I don't even know if he's into this thing, you know? And I was looking at that as a child, like, I'm like, these people just don't even know me or care about me. So, you know, you pile on the fact that my mom was getting completely wasted every single Christmas with the fact that I just felt, you know, alone in my own family. Like, I just couldn't wait to go back home where my dad showed me the attention that I wanted and I could be around my friends and stuff like that. I just hated Christmas. So, you know, fast forward years and years later when I finally started drinking and using drugs and stuff. And Christmas for a drug addict, man, it is the best day and the worst day. It is depressing. I look back and like when you're a drug addict or alcoholic like me, like I was excited for days like Christmas just because it meant a day off of work where I could literally go in and out of blackouts all day long. All day long. Just from the time I woke up, you know, and just chug some, you know, Bacardi and pass back out. Or I'd wake up, crush some pills, snort them, fall asleep, maybe just watch some Christmas movies all messed up. Like, I wasn't visiting family. I wasn't hanging out with friends. Sometimes I would hang out with friends if they were the type that were partying on Christmas Eve. But other than that, it was very lonely and isolating. But, like, to me, like, that was a perfect scenario, you know, nobody bothering me. All my roommates would be out with their families and stuff. And I just made sure I stocked up. Now, when you combine like being a drug addict on Christmas, like, man, we are a hot mess. Because like if you're a drug addict or you're a recovering drug addict, you know exactly what I mean. Like, first off, vacations are nightmares because you gotta load up. You gotta get as much as you can before you go. And then you try to like ration it and you're like, oh, well, I use this much per day. So if I get this many pills for this many days, you know, then I'll be fine, right? And since we're drug addicts, we always use way more. So like I would have to stock up the days before Christmas because to be honest, like a lot of my drug dealers were old women and a lot of them were like hanging out with their families that day. So it was a very bad situation for me to run out of drugs on Christmas Day and then like begging my old lady drug dealer to meet up with me on Christmas to give me more drugs, right? And, you know, living in Las Vegas, I didn't really have to worry about the alcohol issue too much. Bars are open. All the bars are open. Grocery stores. Some of them might close early. But like, that's what's messed up about addiction too, is like every move you make is about getting drunk or high. I had to plan ahead. I had to be very like very structured with my thinking and what I was doing. How am I going to make sure I have enough before the holiday? Because I don't know if I'll be able to get some. Like, this thing is a full-time job. And if any of you addicts are out there who are in recovery, like I always challenge my clients to remember how much effort actually went to our addiction, like how much we were actually doing. This was a 24/7 job, right? And I challenge my clients to remember that, or anybody early in recovery, because all of a sudden we get sober and we just think it's gonna happen. We just think we're gonna stay clean. Like, we just have to put a little bit of effort. They used to tell me, if you put any even half of the effort into staying clean that you did your act of addiction, you'll be just fine, right? And when I kind of quantified that, and I was like, okay, so my addiction was 24/7. So if I even put half of that, which would be, you know, 12 hours a day and 3.5 days a week, I'll be fine. And the reality is once you actually start doing recovery stuff, it's a lot less than that. They're asking for like maybe an hour a day. You know what I mean? The suggestion is 90 meetings in 90 days. And then like after that, you know, you keep going that much, or you kind of taper off. But really, recovery is a lot less effort than it is to be an active addiction. So yeah, for years I was just doing that. And, you know, as a parent who is in active addiction, like, you know, that's one of the worst things. And I'm gonna do a video about work-life balance. And here's the thing. When my son was born and I was still in my active addiction because I didn't get clean until he was three, I was always physically there. I was physically there with him on the holidays, on Christmas, you know, Christmas Eve, I got presents. And I had to strategize how much money I was spending on presents, because I could buy him a lot of stuff for Christmas, but I also had to make sure I had enough money for drugs and for booze. And like, that's a terrible thing to do as a parent. You know what I mean? Like, I had to figure out how many presents I'm gonna get this kid, or is it gonna cut into my drug fund? And his birthday's on New Year's Eve, so I really had to be strategic about this. But even though I was physically there with him on the holidays, like, I wasn't there. Like, I look back at some of the old Christmas photos, like Facebook does, like on this day. And I look back, you know, I'm 5.5 years clean now. And I look back 6-7 years ago when I was with my son, and I don't even remember those pictures. Like, I wasn't there. I wasn't mentally there. I was hiding alcohol around the house. I was sneaking off to the bathroom to go snort pills, you know, and things like that. And eventually, you know, I just wasn't really even seeing him that much on the holidays towards my last year of active addiction. But anyways, that's how terrible it is to be a drug addict. And like I said, I hope you all realize how depressing it is for the most exciting day of the year just to be, you have a day off because of a holiday where you can isolate and get messed up. But anyways, now let's talk about recovery. Let's talk about an addict in recovery celebrating Christmas. So one thing that I do today, I'm recording this on Christmas Eve. Tomorrow morning, I'm not seeing my son, and I choose not to see my son Christmas morning so I can go work. I work at a drug and alcohol rehab center. I work at a rehab center in Las Vegas. 90% of our clients are from out of state, and I purposely go in there and I share my story, or I do something with them because that is the most important thing I could do. Because my first year sober, I missed all of the holidays with my son. I missed every single one. Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas, his birthday, Father's Day, Easter, every single holiday, because I was in California getting clean. So I know how difficult it is for people to be away from their families. So my first year clean, it was very depressing. It was very difficult to be away from my son. But I knew that I was doing this for the bigger picture. Here I am 5.5 years later. I have not missed a Christmas with my son. And what I mean by that is, after I do what I do at my drug and alcohol rehab center in the morning, I go spend the rest of the day with my son. And he knows this. He's okay with this. His mom's okay with this. Christmas. Like, she knows how big of a deal it is for me to go and share at my drug and alcohol rehab center. So that first Christmas was very difficult and depressing, just being away from my son. The second Christmas, right when I came back to Las Vegas in the summer of my second year sober, and it took me a few months to get a job. I finally got a job. I had warrants out for my arrest here in Las Vegas. So that first Christmas back in Las Vegas with my son, I had to pay off these warrants for my arrest, and I couldn't buy him a single present. And like, that is some demoralizing, degrading, embarrassing stuff. But again, like, you know, I had to look at the bigger picture. I had to look at, like, okay, what's more valuable? Me buying my son some things, he's 4 years old at this time, buy him some things that he's probably not going to play with, may not remember, or his dad going to jail in 2 months because he has warrants out for his arrest, right? Like, I had to really, like, think about that. Now, the second part that I need to share, because a lot of addicts struggle with rebuilding relationships with their families in early recovery. So that first Christmas back in Las Vegas, when I couldn't buy my son anything, my son's mom actually took extra presents that she had bought and she put my name on them. And the reason why that's so important was because at this time she was still pretty upset with me. She still didn't trust me fully. She still didn't even think I was going to stay sober, even though I was a year and a half clean. But I had to really consciously notice that she was putting in effort, and she did want me to be there for my son. She wanted my son to see me as a good father. So it was really a big, grand gesture that she actually put my name on some of the presents that she bought for him since I couldn't. Now, let's get into my third Christmas sober. This is where I think a lot of parents in recovery screw up, because I definitely did. Now I had a job. Now I had money saved up. Now I was making money. My son's 5, 6 years old at this time, and now it's time for me to overcompensate, right? I felt so guilty about his first three Christmases of me being a drug addict. I felt guilty about the first two Christmases of my sobriety when I couldn't really get him anything or I wasn't with him. So I spent way too much money on him. I bought him so much stuff. I think I got him a Wii U and a ton of games and Legos and toys and just all these things. And it was, you know, this is what we do in early recovery. We try to overcompensate because we feel so guilty, and we get these things. We get these things, right? Like, don't get it twisted. My son loves presents. He loves presents. But you know what he loves more than presents? He loves having a sober dad with him on Christmas, you know? But I was trying to make myself feel better, and I was trying to maybe even outwardly look like I was doing better to everybody. Like, look at all these toys I bought my son. I bought my son, like, you know, taking pictures of all of it, posting it on social media, his smiles and stuff like that. Like, my motives for buying him all those things were not correct. I was doing it to compensate for the guilt I felt and trying to prove to other people that look how amazing I'm doing now that I'm sober, you know? And then, you know, it put me in debt. I was broke for the next few months. You know what I mean? And that's like, I was putting myself in a bad situation. You know, now when it comes to Christmas with my son, like, I don't overextend. He's in the other room, so I'll be quiet. But, you know, I got him a decent amount of stuff. I got him, like, what a normal parent should get their kid. And, like, the best gift I can give to this kid is just being there for him, being there with him. You know, he doesn't have a drug addict, alcoholic father anymore. You know, he has a father who's in recovery, and he just wants to spend time with me. I got presents that, you know, like Legos and video games that we can play together and spend quality time with. So it's not just that initial, like, oh, I opened a present. It's like, these are giving us long-term value, because, you know, that's the best part about being sober too with a kid is, you know, having similar interests. Now he's about to turn 9 in about a week on New Year's Eve. And he has all the same interests that I do. So I can do things where I get to spend time with him, because he has, you know, he loves Star Wars. He loves Marvel. He loves, you know, music. He loves all these things that I love. And it's amazing. But, you know, the other things too is, like, in my recovery, like, my family is in California, and you know, now, like, another thing that my son's mom, like, I'm gonna do an interview with her soon for my channel, because I know a lot of people struggle with rebuilding relationships, especially with their kids' parents. And me and her have such a beautiful relationship now. And, you know, on these holidays, like Christmas, she knows I'm away from my family. Like, they invite me over. They invite me over to spend, you know, have a Christmas dinner with them or Christmas Eve dinner with them. Her family welcomes me with open arms. I have an amazing relationship with her family. I have an amazing relationship with her new husband. They have a son, you know what I mean? And I can go over there and it's not awkward, it's not weird. And they invite me into their home because they know my family is back in California. But, you know, other than that, I have my friends. I have my beautiful girlfriend. I'm actually going over there tonight for Christmas Eve dinner. I have other people actually inviting me to stuff. Like, it's crazy how much different my Christmases are now. I have to buy people presents now because people actually want to buy me gifts. Like, I'm not this, like, loser, like, drug addict who just isolates and destroys relationships with people. Like, I have people sending me presents. I have clients at my rehab giving me presents and stuff. Like, you know, the holidays for me now are just absolutely, you know, beautiful. And, you know, I get to wish people a Merry Christmas and call my parents just to say Merry Christmas. You know, my mom's in recovery now, too. And, you know, I miss my family back there, but I know they're doing well. And, you know, we talk on the phone and things like that. So, you know, if nothing else, like, I really hope that some of you out there who are either in your active addiction or in early recovery, or if you know somebody out there who is in active addiction or in early recovery, like, I hope what you got from this video is that things do get better. Things get better. It takes work, though. It takes effort. Like I said in the beginning of this video, we have to put effort into our recovery. We have to put effort into our mental health. That's why I have this channel. So make sure that you're watching these other videos on my channel. Like, we have to work on our mental health in order to have these beautiful holidays and just be, you know, as normal as possible. Like, this is a beautiful time of year. It's no longer depressing for me, you know, because I have people in my life who love me and I love them, you know. But it takes time. It takes time. I hope what the other thing you got from this video is, my first two sober Christmases sucked. They sucked, but now they're so much better. And it didn't take 5 years for them to get better. It took a couple years, but they're much better now. So if nothing else, the goal of this video is to give some of you hope. Hopefully you stayed around to the end of this video. And like I said, like, what I've been telling all of you lately, like, if you ever need to get a hold of me, feel free to reach out either in the YouTube comments. You can email me at therewiredsoul.com. I'll put up my Instagram again right here. A lot of people DM me who are struggling from all over the world. And just, you know, I'm always around to talk. You know, I might not reply immediately, but I'm always down to have a conversation. Even if you're not an addict or a recovering addict, if you have a loved one, I'm more than happy to talk to you too. But anyways, y'all, I really hope that you have a Merry Christmas, and just remember, try to realize that big picture and what we're working towards. I highly suggest you check out my other video I'll put in the info card, The Real Gratitude Challenge. Like, we need to quit just only being happy and nice to each other on Christmas and around the holidays. We need to start doing that 365 days a year. That's when your mental health really improves and you start enjoying life a lot better. But anyways, y'all, if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. And if you are new here, again, hit the little round subscribe button. I'm always making videos to help you out with your mental health. I make videos about addiction recovery. As well, click or tap to the left of me right over here. Check out one of those thumbnails because it's another video that'll help you out. Thanks for watching. Merry Christmas. I'll see you next time.